political parties may now and then answer popular ends, they are likely, in the course of time and things, to become potent engines by which cunning, ambitious, and unprincipled men will be enabled to subvert the power of the people and to usurp for themselves the reins of government, destroying afterwards the very engines which have lifted them to unjust dominion.
You can't say they didn't warn us. Now, I'm not saying that George Washington was some superior moral authority because, you know, slaves, but he had a point here. And we all know that hindsight is 20/20, but clearly Washington's foresight was too. Hi, I'm Maria. If you're new here, welcome. Thank you so much for being here. I talk about America and its present and its history and its place in the world and what it all means. So welcome. So today I wanted to, you know, keep it light, keep it easy, keep it casual, and talk about a super minor, super easy, super non-controversial topic: politics and morality. So if you're on social media, you've probably seen posts that are something along the lines of, there is a difference between having a political opinion and then believing that someone's existence is wrong or less valuable. I've seen posts like that a lot of times. I've actually liked them and shared them myself, full disclosure, because at first glance it seems super intuitive to believe that. But I actually wanted to explore it a little bit further because I think there's a lot of conversation to be had here. The implication here is that, you know, while some matters can be argued about as political opinions, there is an overarching moral imperative that is, or that at least should be, untouched by politics. Posts and arguments like these are founded upon the idea that some matters just go without saying. They are unquestionable and irrefutable. You know, statements like, every human being deserves to live and live freely are statements that, for the most part, that's a topic for another day, have transcended politics and become irrefutable human rights. Obviously, my initial statement, the one that poses political opinions and moral questions as inherently incompatible things, leads to a lot of questions, and we're gonna explore them. But the first, and believe it or not, simplest question I want to get to is there a difference between political opinion and morality, at least through the lens of American politics? Like, really, is there, practically? I think we should start at the beginning. Let's look at this country's foundational documents. I'm full of quotes today. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created. We hold these truths to be self- We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That's lovely. It's ethical. And I think most people would agree that this is an objectively right statement. But at the same time, it wasn't correct. When the Declaration of Independence, which starts out by stressing the importance of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, was written, there were literally people in bondage in the country to which this declaration applied. At the time that this document was written, human beings were being enslaved and bought and traded like property and continued to be that way for nearly 100 more years. Though the declaration uses the word all men, and doesn't mention that people are only entitled to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness if they qualify. There is no doubt that these three allegedly unalienable and fundamental human rights upon which this entire country's governmental system was based were very heavily gatekept. And I get it. You might be saying, okay, this was 300 years ago, Maria, get with the fucking times. But this is important because the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution are the foundational documents of the American political system and, of course, of the American government. This country's independence was declared by a document whose opening statement is highly moralistic. The independence of this country was declared by a document whose opening statement is highly moralistic and evocative of ethical questions. but it's also very unrepresentative of the realities of its time. Before I get any further, by the way, I want to backtrack and say that I agree, right? I think that there should be political opinions, and then there should be moral truths from which we do not stray. To say that politics and morality in this country are two inherently separate things that are at odds with each other, and to fail to acknowledge that politics and morality have been very closely tied together in this country since its literal beginning, is to take a lot of nuance out of the conversation. And that's so important because by acknowledging that the relationship between politics and morality is much more complicated than they should be separate, we can also acknowledge the moral inconsistencies and immoral realities of our current political system. No government would exist without morality as a reference point. How else do you codify right and wrong? That's why it's so complicated. So let's make it a little bit more complicated by diving a little bit deeper into the structure of our political system. And I don't think that we can do that without talking about tribalism. Tribalism is essentially a sense of loyalty to a given community or group that is so strong that it creates behavioral patterns and attitudes. Tribalism essentially establishes the us versus them mentality. And I'm really not coming from a place of like, yeah, tribalism sucks. No, we're all tribalistic. We seek community and we tend to gravitate toward groups and people whose moral codes are compatible with our own. And this can be wonderful. You know, it creates companionship, it creates culture, and it gives us a sense of togetherness. And it can also be divisive and separatist and devolve into hatred when left unchecked. And that's, I think, exactly what George Washington was talking about. I mean, and even using our political system as a reference point, what is more compatible with us versus them than a political system that is limited to two political parties whose ideologies are entirely at odds with each other? It's a recipe for extreme tribalism. There simply is not a lot of room for nuance when there's not a lot of room for options. Moral questions that can be broken down into hundreds of smaller components, each of which can be broken down into dozens of smaller arguments, they're boiled down to their most basic big picture concepts within a two-party system. For example, let's get controversial. Let's talk about illegal immigration real quick. Hey guys, what's up? Just interjecting really quick, as per usual. The example that I'm about to give is really to highlight how nuanced and complicated a lot of the questions that can be sort of glossed over by something as polarized as a two-party electoral system can be. So I, for the sake of the example, am kind of at least starting out from the perspective of someone who is kind of anti-undocumented immigration in general. I just want to be very clear that that is not my personal belief at all, for multiple reasons, all of which I will get into further down the line on this channel. But one of the reasons that I started this channel is because I believe that immigrants in general are one of the most misunderstood and one of the most vulnerable demographics in this country. And my goal is to really try and bust a lot of myths and combat a lot of the misconceptions about immigration, both legal and quote unquote illegal. So I just wanted to be really clear that I'm trying to be as objective as possible in this example, but it in no way reflects my personal beliefs. I don't think anyone really cares, and I think you guys kind of get that, but it's something that matters a lot to me, so I just wanted to make it really clear. Thank you! This is something that I think, given our increasingly polarized political environment, elicits a lot of visceral responses from people, myself included, but the question of legal immigration is so much more nuanced than there is room to acknowledge in our current political climate. Let's dive in as an example. So you have the moral question of, does someone have the right to cross a country's border without permission, thereby taking up space and resources in that country? You might, as a lot of people do, sort of boil it down to a more personal example, thinking of, okay, well, no one has the right to come into my house, right, without permission and take my food and take up space in my bed. So no, someone does not have the right to come into a country without permission and take up resources. I think for the most part, questions of immigration at a broad scale under a two-party system essentially stop there, right? Does someone have the right to come into this country without permission and take up resources and space? Yes or no? And of course, emotional arguments and slightly more detailed answers to that question may arise in support or in condemnation of an answer, but really, that's the big question that's asked when it comes to immigration as a voting issue, right? But let's get a little bit more nuanced than that first question. Let's think about, okay, well, maybe someone might not be cool with an illegal immigrant just coming in. So let's get a little bit more nuanced. Let's say that the person who illegally immigrates into a country was living in absolute misery and poverty in their country of origin and would have died within the year had they not escaped. What if that person's young children would have become victims of political violence or would have starved to death had they not made that journey? Here, some people might begin to break off. Maybe if they answered no to that first question, here they might reconsider. They might say, well, shit, if it's a question of life or death, then yeah, you can flee your homeland and seek refuge somewhere else. Others might still say no, you have no right to cross borders illegally. Let's get a little bit more nuanced than that. What if the people who cross the border without permission don't take away resources? What if they actually add resources in by investing in local businesses, by supporting the country's economy, and by paying taxes without reaping the benefits of those taxes? What then? On top of that, what about their children, right? Are these children to be blamed and punished and sent back to a country they don't know, into danger potentially, just because they were brought here as infants or as 7, 8, 9, 10-year-olds? What's to be done about them? I could keep going. We could keep getting more and more nuanced. And I don't have an agenda here. I'm not attempting to sway anyone who's listening's opinion anyway. I'm just pointing out the fact that these conversations are so deeply nuanced and there's very little room for them in an increasingly polarized two-party system where you either agree with an overarching moral question or you disagree, despite the many, many qualifications that could sway you either way. The point is that most of the contentious issues on which we vote are morally gray to some extent. They're not black or white. What the two-party system does is force voters into this artificial consistency. Our political system is inherently moralistic. Moralistic ideas serve as not only the foundation for our entire governmental system, but for the stances that every voter takes today and for the party with which they choose to identify. That said, both history and current events show us that moralistic and moral are not the same thing. Now, should there be a set of inflexible moral stances that our political, governmental, and legal system unilaterally accept and enforce? I think so. And our legal documents seem to think so as well. They've thought so from the very beginning, as we went over before. In this situation, theory isn't the problem. Execution is. Because it's one thing to say that all men are created equal, assuming that men is the standard for human beings, because, you know,
patriarchy.
It's another entirely to guarantee equality for all men. Our political system is built for the big, catch-all, overarching questions and statements. Is illegal immigration wrong? Is abortion wrong? Right? These big, overarching questions. Yes or no? What becomes much more complicated is accounting for the fact that human beings are nuanced and therefore have nuanced opinions. No two human beings are the same. And even if we could arrive at a point where most of us agree on what an equal and just society looks like, it's very difficult to agree on how to get there from where we are. And it's even more difficult when all of the nuanced questions that must be asked in order to get there are inherently incompatible with the grandiose, polarized system under which we need to vote. And it's increasingly difficult when you're sort of limited to two big options and that's about it in order to get there somehow. As I said before, no government can exist without morality as a reference point. The paradox is that these systems are rooted in moral imperatives, but governments always somehow fail from the very outset to guarantee perfect life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness opportunities for every single one of their citizens. That is the paradox of government, because every ensuing action then becomes a moral question rather than a confirmation of the moral imperatives upon which the system was based. And in this video, I really wanted to stress and talk about the very intertwined nature of government and moralism. I personally think it's right to want government to take certain moral imperatives for granted, but to ignore political ethics is to overlook the foundational element of political theory. I've seen a lot of arguments about, for example, what is a political opinion and then what is just a morally reprehensible opinion. And some examples that have been given for like what a political opinion is should our school district receive more funding this year? But even a question like that, which seems extremely dry, right, is rooted in moralistic questions. It's rooted in the belief that every citizen is entitled to public education. And it also lends itself to more complicated questions of, okay, if we allocate these resources to the school district, what endeavor is then going to be missing funding? Politics, even the driest, most seemingly innocuous political questions, are inherently moralistic. Rather than attempting to separate moralism from politics, I think it's important to acknowledge the fact that morality and moralism are intrinsic to governmental systems. I think that governments should be held accountable for upholding the seemingly irrefutable moral truths that they set out to uphold, right? Let's reference the source: life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Yeah, this video is really about establishing the relationship between moralism and politics and why moralism doesn't automatically cancel out immorality. This may feel incomplete. It definitely does to me, but that's because I've decided to split this video up into a few different parts. So this was part one, politics and moralism. I know I referenced it a lot in this video, but next week is when I'm really planning on deep diving into how exactly the moralistic roots of our government combined with the two-party system led to the polarization that we're seeing today. I was originally gonna make it all one video, but girl, that's too much. I chose to tackle a really big topic. I hope it kind of made sense. I feel like I was sort of rambling for a long time. I'm a little bit rusty, haven't written a poli-sci paper in a few years.
Aging myself.
You know, I'm a 25-year-old with a bachelor's degree in science. I do not have a science degree. I mean, political science, social science, not the same thing as like a science. I wish I had more answers than I do questions, but I think that is the beautiful and frustrating thing about studying social sciences, is that you're always gonna have more questions than answers. Yeah, to study politics is really just feeling overwhelmed and inequipped all the time. But regardless, I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you so much for sticking around. If you still have, definitely tune in next week because it's gonna be... Thank you so much for watching. Please check out the description for some resources for donations to the Black Lives Matter movement, to United We Dream, and a link to register to vote. Please, please register to vote if you haven't yet. Please, please. Thank you again so much for watching. I really appreciate it. And please leave some comments about what you'd like to hear me talk about, if you agree or disagree with what I had to say, if I didn't cover some topics that you think I should have, please let me know. And if you like this video, be sure to like and subscribe. And if you want to know when more videos are coming out, then turn on your notifications. Thank you so much. I'll see you next time.